Hey, this is Mike. So last week we began our discussion about Rudolph's shiny new year, and we talked so much that we're doing a two-parter. So join us now for the conclusion of Rudolph's shiny new year.
Some of your favorite cartoon characters will help you understand how drugs and alcohol can ruin your life. So watch the program. Talk about it with your family.
I don't know, but like, anyway, yeah. And then, because when I said what year did everything go bad, my wife was yelling 2016. That would be another interesting year. But you know what? I think it would be great to be a little more lighthearted. It's like, okay, Rudolph, go back to the island, the archipelago. Go to 1920, pick up like a flapper. Go to 19, ni go to 1985, pick up a guy in a members only jacket. And I'm trying to think what other fun things you could do.
Yeah, like Ru basically give Rudolph a sort of A team of favorite years that he could take on various adventures.
And I mean, it's just funny because imagine like. Man, some of those years would be like just really dark, you know? Like you go to one year and it's probably just going to be like one of the 60s years and it's going to be like, yeah, a Vietnam War movie. You're going to be out in the jungle getting shot by Charlie. You go to like, a World War I island and it's going to all be
Ooh.
like, fucking trenches. Go to I'm trying to think. Yeah, go to a medieval year where the plague happened.
Go to
Man.
the 1929, rich people raining down on the street.
Oh, that year sounds awesome. That island sounds awesome.
Oh God, 2001, imagine.
Now that 2001, I think would be a funny island because I bet if you went to it wouldn't actually be anything like the actual year 2001. It would be like the movie 2001. So it'd be a bunch of like monkeys in front of a monolith.
Do you think it would be like that for 1984 too?
Oh yeah, I think it would actually, because I think people actually, if you say 1984, people remember the book more than the actual year. Because what happened in
Oh, and if Rudolph
1984?
goes to the year 1955, it is full of time travelers.
That's the year it happened, you know? What other ones? Like, but there's a lot you could do with this. Obviously we're being, a little we're being a little goofy when thinking of the darker ones, but for a kid special you could have some fun things. I
Yeah,
mean, we
absolutely.
only and we only did caveman, medieval sort of fairy tale and colonial time. I mean, an Egyptian year, a Roman year,
Yeah. Samurai year. Yeah.
Samurai. Ooh, that's a good one. Actually, yeah, and I'm being pretty Eurocentric in what I'm thinking of history, I think. So obviously you'd have a
Well, man,
medieval,
what if you went to the year that the Black Plague happened, and the actual year looked like the Grim Reaper, and it's
Oh, that would
like,
be awesome.
oh, and that the plot of that would be like Father Time lost his scythe. They need to borrow the Grim Reaper's scythe.
Yeah. Oh no, he'd look like one of those plague doctors with the
Oh yeah.
beak.
Oh, you're right. Yeah.
Yeah, actually, man. Okay, you know what? I guess time to go to AO3. Here's the fanfic. There's the fanfic we
Yeah.
gotta do.
Well, we don't have to include Rudolph. We could just do this.
That's
Years
true.
aren't copyrighted.
Yeah, that's true. I mean, just be like, it gets a little odd without Rudolph because it's like, oh yeah, by the way, there's this archipelago,
Yeah.
archipelago, where all the previous years are personified. And be like, wait, what? And it's
Yeah,
like,
you're
okay.
right. Okay, that does if you disconnect it from this as the entry point, then it does sort of it does take a much at least a much more involved opening theme song to introduce people to the idea.
Yeah. I mean, I think actually you could basically just do it as a, like, okay, a time traveler just jumping around and picking up companions as they go, because you're basically then doing Bill and Ted, you know? Yeah,
we're Doctor Who.
Yeah. Oh, yeah, yeah, exactly. Which are also both very good concepts for, you know, a story, I think.
But, well, we've gone all this way through the story, and we haven't actually gotten to the villain yet. And the villain is actually really good in this one.
Yeah. So it's, Eon the Terrible is his name, I think?
Eon the Terrible, yeah. He's like a giant buzzard with fangs in his beak. I'm sure he has terrible breath. And we are informed that Eon, you know, who is generally kind of a minor pest around the sands of time, it will only live to be one eon old. And, you know, there's only been four eons in, you know, time itself. So
really? So oh, wait, what is an eon?
Geologically, it's like a billion years.
Oh, I always thought an eon was just kind of a generic thing, like, oh, a long time. I didn't realize it actually referred to a real period of time.
Well, I may be wrong, too, because I looked up eon. Yes, an eon is the largest division on the time scale. It is not less than a billion years. There are four eons recognized on the geologic time scale: the Hadean eon, the Archean eon, the Proterozoic eon, and the one we're in now, the Phanerozoic. Each of these eons has had a significant difference in climate, the composition of the Earth, and the life forms that lived then. The Hadean, Archean, and Proterozoic eons are collectively known as the Precambrian period. You've probably heard the word Precambrian before.
Right. So are you telling me that life has only existed in this most recent eon then?
Yes, exactly.
Wow, so eons are extremely long.
So eon might have been one of the first things born.
Damn. Okay. So yeah, he is on the chopping block. He is going to die as soon as the
ice and snow, they say.
Right. Now, actually, that is in your... First of all, so an eon, what distinguishes an eon geologically? Because they're extremely long, but what ends it, I guess, is the question. Like, in real life.
Let's see. The Hadean eon was... Okay, the Hadean eon had high temperature and incessant volcanic activity, and nothing could live here. The Archean eon was where the first signs of life forms appeared, the first single-celled organisms. And the climate had cooled enough that you could actually live here, but the atmosphere was filled with volcanic gas. Mm-hmm. Proterozoic was the era of multicellular organisms, and the Earth's temperature dropped significantly. And the Phanerozoic eon is the one where we have, you know, vertebrate life. So,
Okay. So that implies to me, because they said that the eon is going to end in 6 days when the new year begins. That implies that some major geological change is about to happen, like that may end or completely alter all life on Earth. But...
That's kind of alarming. It suggests that, like, Eon was supposed to die because, like, I don't know, the Great Antarctic Ice Shelf broke and sea level rose or something.
Yeah, exactly. So if you think about it, Eon is kind of, I mean, first of all, he doesn't want to turn into ice and snow. So he has a very sympathetic reason for trying to stop the new year from coming, like for personal reasons. But if you think about it, he may also be trying to save all life on Earth.
Yeah.
By,
I mean, he doesn't know what's going to happen. He might, you know, he might be expecting another Chicxulub asteroid or something.
Yeah, yeah. So, I mean, I don't think he's not like, he's doing this for selfish reasons, but it may actually be good for us all if Eon continues to live. Now, he does actually live. Like, he thinks baby Happy... That's the name of the baby, by the way. I don't know if we ever mentioned that the baby's name is Happy. Happy New Year, you know. Mm-hmm. he sees the baby's ears and he laughs so hard that Rudolph says, well, he's not going to turn to ice because he's got so much warm laughter in his heart. So I guess he's fine. That doesn't, I guess that means the eon didn't end, even though the year did. Yeah. So I think we had our cake and ate it too. Yeah, yeah. It all worked out. So,
I like that Eon says it's true as if he knew this all along. It's like, what, did you see this happen before, Eon?
It's like, I feel like we could have saved a lot of time, Eon, if you knew this.
Well, for, I don't know. I feel like Eon is kind of the reverse of a phoenix. You know, mm-hmm. Yeah, they turn into flame and then become another phoenix. I wonder if, you know, if he had turned into ice and snow, you know, it would have become a snow egg that hatched into a new Eon.
That's a good point. I mean, it does seem to imply that, like, every Eon will have a... I wonder if, yeah, like the New Year's baby, there's a new one, you know, like, every Eon. Yeah.
Is there an archipelago of last Eons?
I mean, I guess there is... This isn't really explored much in this special, but it does make an interesting contrast between the New Year's baby and an Eon, because they're both... personifications that end, and yes. You know,
the
idea
of a very hard limit.
Yeah. Yeah. So, you know, you can kind of see it would be interesting if like that was part of their connection, why the baby went to Eon. It was like, yeah, here's another person who, like me, you know, they're just trying to live. They're trying to like, they're trying to get away from that like imposed limit. And you know, you could kind of explore that and be like, look, I mean, obviously nobody wants to die. We all wish we could live forever, but that ain't happening. And at a certain point, like you have to accept that, like, you know, your race is run and you've had your time in the sun and it's your time, you know? And, both Eon and the New Year's baby are kind of, you know, to some degree, fighting against that inevitability. But we don't really talk about that much. It could be really good. Actually, that would be very interesting if the plot of this was Father Time being like, yeah, I'm not giving up my throne. Fuck the new year. I'm staying, you know?
That was the plot of one of those proposed sequels to Witch's Night Out, remember?
Oh, I forgot about that. Well, they should have done it because it's a good idea. Yeah.
I really want those to get done. I hope there's some news about them soon.
Man, they've been trying for a long time.
Mm-hmm.
Well, like, see, I guess, you know, whatever. When you get the gift of winter, let me know.
Yeah, for real.
But anyway, so yeah, that doesn't really come up. Eon is fine. He laughs and he's fine. And I guess the Eon continues, even though the year doesn't. They get the year baby back.
And he turns out to be the year 19 wonderful.
Yeah, because I guess they figured, like, look, by the end of the century, nobody's gonna be watching this holiday special anymore. Little do they know.
Oh, also, it's important to remember that this all happened the same Christmas that Rudolph saved Christmas by leading the sleigh.
That's right. Man, Rudolph cannot get a break.
Yeah. I mean, like, as soon as he revealed how useful he was, he became Santa's top agent.
That's the thing. It's like, it's kind of weird that at first Santa was like, okay, Rudolph, this is on you again. And at first it's like the justification is because, oh, there's a storm, so you need to do it because you're the one with the glowing nose. But it's like, okay, that storm only is around Santa's place in North Pole. Once you get away from that, there's no storm. You can get around easily. So, but it does in the end kind of make sense for Rudolph to be the guy because he does have that connection with Happy in that they were both mocked for their appearance.
Yeah. If there's a real moral to this special, it's kind of an early take on It Gets Better.
Yeah. So I guess you could say that Rudolph is a queer special. It's a queer narrative.
In some ways. I mean, I would hate to think that, you know, the experience for young queer people was finding that, you know, now everyone likes my queerness because it's useful to them. But, you know, maybe maybe you don't have to be loved by everybody. Maybe you can just be loved by one person and that's good enough.
Yeah. This is, but yeah, it is, cause Rudolph kind of, he does make that connection with Happy toward the end when they meet, and Rudolph basically says like, yeah, I too have known the pain of being different. And, actually, yeah, you know, it's funny cause like Hermie and Cornelius, like you said, this starts the same night as Rudolph's, regular thing, but Hermie and Cornelius, you're like, yeah, we're not getting involved this time. You're on your own. Have fun.
Oh, also, they retell the story in cell animation rather than stop motion. And this is big, chewy chunks of Paul Coker Jr. all over the place.
Yeah.
And yeah. It's like, that is the thing. If he had ever had an anime, it would look like that.
I feel like that is the thing about Rankin Bass, is they had two modes. There's kind of puppetoon mode, and there's that very kind of chunky, big eyes, gangly necks and arms, kind of Hobbit type animation. I don't know how you would even describe this style of animation, but it's very, it's only Rankin Bass. They do it.
Well, the animation from Rankin Bass was commissioned from a company called Topcraft. This was a Japanese studio that did a lot of outsourced animation from the United States like this. But when Topcraft closed down, most of its animators moved to a new upstart studio you might have heard of called Studio Ghibli.
Oh, okay. So you mean, thanks to Rankin Bass is why we have Princess Mononoke.
Yeah. And just think, some people did character designs for both Spirited Away and Thundercats.
Wow. This is a, it's definitely a very distinctive Rankin Bass look. It's so distinctive that I feel like, yeah, Rankin Bass is probably telling the studio like, okay, can you make these characters uglier? Can you make them like just disgusting? Like, we want these like Rango style ugly, you know?
I got two words for you, Japan. Klasky Chupo.
Yeah. This is definitely like shades of Rugrats ugliness in this, you know?
Not quite Rocket Power bad, but
No. But yeah, it's definitely a look, and I feel like it is. I know Rankin Bass, this is probably like, I don't know. They've been around for a while. I really associate this particular look with the 70s. I feel like there was kind of a, the 70s were kind of the decade when it's like, can we just make everything just look as shitty as possible? Like, well, yeah,
most of these specials did come out in the 70s. Like, there were two in the 60s, and then like one in 1992, and one in 2001, and then a couple in the 2000s, and the rest of them are all from the 70s.
Yeah, I mean, the 70s, it was just like, look, just make all the colors look like someone just like puked, make the music as tinny as possible. There was just this real push in the 70s, I just feel like, let's just make art unappealing as much as we can. I mean, you got to respect it because, you know, it's a choice. And I feel like the Rankin Bass really just kind of fits into that milieu so well.
Does it remind you a lot of course, the special we watched about Jack-O-Lantern?
Oh, that drunken Irishman. Yeah. Was it? Oh my God. Wow. That was, yeah, wasn't that Rankin Bass? Was that Rankin Bass? Yeah, that was Rankin Bass. Yeah. They really love just like mixing up holidays like that. They're like, what if we made, what if it was Halloween, but like more leprechaun-y? Yeah, it makes sense. Yeah, why not?
Let's do a story about how the Easter Bunny invented Secretary's Day.
Yeah. You know, when you think about it, it's pretty surprising though Rankin Bass people were involved with the Nightmare Before Christmas.
Were they?
I didn't think so, but you know, maybe I'm wrong.
You're surprised they weren't, or surprised they were?
Yeah, that they were not.
Okay, yeah, because they were not. Yeah, Nightmare Before Christmas was actually made using animators who had cut their teeth on the Gumby revival in the '80s.
Oh wow. Okay. Well, you see how these things just kind of like they all connect in weird ways. Mm-hmm. The '80s Gumby revival though.
Yeah.
I'm a classic Gumby head. So
yeah, I mean, way too much synth in those, honestly.
Yeah, but. I'm telling you. Yeah, Gumby's in a band now. He's got a sister. What's this fucking mastodon doing around? Why is there a chicken?
The mastodon was in the old ones too.
Mm-hmm. Oh, sorry.
The mastodon was in the old ones too. Yeah, the thing about Gumby is that Art Clokey always assumed that you were as familiar with Gumby as he was and was not about to retell how everyone got back together. So you just have to, you know, so if you don't know who the Groovy is and why it builds wild boxes around everything, too bad for you.
Yeah, I mean, that's... Art Clokey, what a wild man, you know.
Yes.
truly the best that ever did it. I think, you know, but I think the 60s Gumby, you know, I like the 60s Gumby where, you know, yeah. Where Art Clokey had, you know, he just got back from that acid trip with Frank Zappa and he was just like, I gotta spread the gospel of Buddha to America's children. And he made Gumby and, yep. Good on him for it, because that's the good shit. But at least 80s Gumby gave us Rankin Bass Puppetoon people. Oh, I'm sorry, the Nightmare Before Christmas, I guess.
Yes, it gave us the Nightmare Before Christmas and James and the Giant Peach. And there was going to be a third movie that they never completed called Lost and Found Love. Almost nobody knows about this one anymore. It was going to be a movie about a whale who goes on dry land to find his girlfriend who was kidnapped by a water park.
Oh, okay. That sounds interesting.
Seen one screenshot from it that ran in Wild Cartoon Kingdom magazine.
Does the whale, is it like, I'm going back to the land of my ancestors, dry land?
Yeah, pretty much. He puts on a little sailor hat and gets hired on a boat, so they'll take him to land.
Wow. Okay. Well, I guess it's unfortunate we'll never get to see that one.
Yeah. I would like to at least see the script they were working from.
Yeah. Well, in any case, so Rudolph successfully gets the baby back, defeats Eon, everyone's happy. I do think it's funny how when he meets Happy and Rudolph acts surprised that Happy doesn't know Rudolph. You know, don't you know my story? Yeah. Don't you know Rudolph? It's like, Rudolph, it happened a week ago.
He's a baby. He technically hasn't actually been born yet.
Yeah, it's like, Rudolph's too modest to tell a story, so the wind and the rain and the snow tell it instead. And it's just like, oh, great, thanks. Yeah. That is the one thing about this special that I think is the weakest, is that every 2 minutes they have to have another goddamn song.
Yeah, we haven't really gotten into the songs because they're just not very memorable, honestly. The best one is Father Time's song.
Yeah, that one's not too bad. In general, though, this is from the 70s, so this was before The Little Mermaid. This was before they realized you could put rock music in cartoons. So yes. They're all very just like...
However, woo! It was only 1 year before... it was 4 years before The Return of the King, so we hadn't yet gotten Where There's a Whip, There's a Way.
But they were on their way. Yeah, this one just... The songs are just very much like... I don't know how you would describe this kind of music. It's just filler baby-ish. Music, you know? Filler it's music like, for children that won't get
yeah,
them...
It's like the musical equivalent of Veal.
Yeah.
Music this is that's a been kind kept of, in a box and treated cruel.
Yeah. Like, this is music that, like, they used to put like in kids stuff this kind of music all the time, because I think the idea is like you could put your kid in front of the TV and like just leave them there for hours and you wouldn't have to worry that they'd accidentally hear any of that devil music, you know.
Yeah.
Instead they just get this like, oh, okay, don't worry, we're only going to subject your child to the blandest of music. Mm. They won't get any ideas from this, don't worry.
Yeah, you don't want anything that's going to get your kids up and dancing and knocking down things.
Oh yeah, you don't want that. You don't want them like, you don't want them, you do not want a fat beat that they can bug out to. You want them to just lie there when they hear them. You want music that when you hear it, it makes you feel like the doldrums in the Phantom Tollbooth. just lying there with totally inert, not any sort of stimulus response. This music is not good. It's not good music.
And we were 10 years away from, well, actually, no, 8 years away from Heathcliff, Heathcliff, no one should terrorize their neighborhood.
Yeah, now that is music. That is music, man. Now, when you hear Heathcliff, I mean, well, the thing is, like, Heathcliff get away with it because Heathcliff was, like, kind of a rabble-rouser. So I think most parents would just be like, no, I'm not going to let my kid watch Heathcliff to begin with. So only the cool kids could watch it. You know, kids could handle hearing kind of a jaunty rock anthem without, like, their heads exploding. So, you know, that was what Heathcliff was about. Heathcliff Heathcliff was about testing the limits of the system.
Heathcliff wasn't about music. It was about rebellion.
That's right. That's right.
But, you know, what is Rudolph a rabble rouser too? Do you think that there were parents who were like, I don't want you want you watching that Rudolph. I don't want you thinking that you can't judge people by their appearance.
Well, considering this is America, yeah, I bet there are a lot of people who don't. Man, you know, there people are just like that. You couldn't make this holiday special today because of woke. You know, people would just be like, can't believe Rudolph went woke. Can't believe he's telling us not to judge people by their appearance. Ugh, this is what happens when you let women touch puppetoons.
Do the dumb things you gotta do. Touch the puppetoons. Yeah.
Anyway, anything else about Rudolph's Shiny New Year?
We didn't go through it, scene by scene like we did last time, but, you know, there's not that much to sell because, you know, it's just, you know, scene after scene of weird shit happening, and that's good enough for me sometimes, you know?
Yeah, yeah.
I hate Baby Bear, but I like Papa Bear. I like the bear family looks very Muppety. I like them.
Yeah, yeah, the bear family's fine. Baby Bear's pretty annoying. And he does that thing that they do a lot in kids' shows. A lot of people do this, actually, in this episode, where they just approach someone and immediately are like, hey, you want to be friends? You want to be friends? I'll be your friend. Like, that sort of thing. It's like, I'm sorry, that is not something that you really do in real life. It's like, it happens, you know? You don't just announce, yeah, we're friends now. We just met. We've decided to become friends. We've made the logical, informed decision that we ought to be friends after meeting once. Especially funny when New Year, the happy New Year's baby meets Benjamin Franklin, and Benjamin Franklin is all like, you want to be friends? It's like, you're what, like a 60-year-old man, and this is a baby? You want to be friends? What is going on?
Baby, would you say I'm adopting you, or would you say, here, I'm your friend, you can trust me, let's try and get you back to your parents?
I mean, that's true, but he doesn't really do that. He's just kind of like, oh, you want to be friends? We're going to go watch a parade. I feel like it's like, I'm sorry, is this the island of 1776, or is this the island of Little St. James? Anyway, Jeffrey Epstein jokes never go out of fashion. Ooh. Ask your parents, kids.
If somebody says I want to be friends, it feels like, you know, a trapdoor spider has popped up behind you. It's like, yeah, get away.
Yeah. Yeah, it's like, you know, maybe think this through a little bit, but yeah, Baby Bear does that thing where he's like, oh, let's be friends. It is funny when Papa Bear is just like, well, another mouth to feed. I think it's kind of adorable that they're like immediately willing to adopt this baby, you know.
Yeah, it's Papa Bear comes across as kind of gruff, but you know, clearly he has baby's best interests in mind, and he's like, oh my God, my kid has a friend. I'm so happy. And
yeah.
But no, what's really funny about this special is that we keep getting more and more more out of the way reasons for Happy to have to take off his hat. It just feels like somebody was just like uh-oh, it's that time. Gotta take off your hat. Come on.
Yeah, I'm not it's filming. Very much.
Go ahead.
It's a lot like in The Simpsons where it was all like, you know, they started having trouble coming up with reasons. I mean, you're looking at Car's tailpipe, but you know, they had good writers for that. So they have, cause I know like he has to take off his hat because a parade goes by. So he has to like, you know, show respect for the flag and that I buy that. Okay. Cause you're in the America patriotic island. And a pterodactyl egg knocks his hat off. That's, yeah. The one that's crazy is when he's doing the game with Baby Bear, and Baby Bear's like, you've killed me. Now you have to take off your hat to do a dashing, you know.
Yeah. If you want to take off your hat, we're not friends.
Yeah, it's like, okay. And then the baby's like, I'm leaving. And he's like, why are you leaving? We're friends. Like, yeah, you don't seem like a good friend to have, actually, Baby Bear. No. You're kind of pushy.
Yeah.
But anyway, yeah. But in the end, I guess it's okay. I guess Happy realizes it's okay to have big ears.
I guess so. I mean, so is 19 Wonderful the year that everybody had big ears? What do you think that
happens? That's how it's gonna. That's how it's gonna be remembered.
Wait a minute. I think this whole year is probably pretty well defined by everything that Rudolph and his friends went through to try to rescue Happy. So if you go to the island of 19 Wonderful, it's probably just this happening over and over.
God, that's weird. Because imagine Rudolph has to go back to the archipelago of lost years for some reason, right? And he happens to visit the island of 19 Wonderful, and he sees himself doing this stuff, like a clone, right? So he'd be like, what the fuck is that?
Yeah, that is weird. And so what happened? Yeah. And what happens if the real Rudolph goes and sees the shadow Rudolph and stops him? If he doesn't rescue Happy, does it change everything?
I mean, that's a good question. Boy, it's getting real existential.
You know, how much of what's happening on the islands is, you know, everything that happened in real time, and how much is just, you know, like you said, going through the motions, the shadow puppets.
Yeah. I don't know. It's a little weird because
able to speak to them, you know. You know, it's not like Baby Bear ever met Happy before. And also, the real Baby Bear has been dead for a millennium.
Yeah. Well, there's also the interesting thing about, like, that one island, 1776. It's not only that it's always 1776, it's always July 4th.
Yeah. Are other places like that, where it's always one single day? Is 10-2-3 also like that? Did all the fairy tales also happen in the same day? What a day!
I don't know. I wonder if it's like, again, the year who goes there gets to pick some of this stuff. Like, maybe, I don't know. Well, actually, no, it's weird because when Baby appears on 1776, like, the Benjamin Franklin says, you might think it's December, but it's always July 4th here. So he is aware that in the real world, it is December.
Yeah. Oh, and also, do you remember what actually happened on July 4th, 1776? They didn't have the parade then.
No, what did they do on July 4th, 1776?
I believe that was when Cornwallis surrendered to Washington. I might be wrong.
Oh, well, you know, they did. Yeah, that's a whole different vibe. I think it's like basically the island is like, welcome to TGIF Mixed Scratchies, where every night is New Year's Eve. Oh man, these islands just get weirder and weirder, but I think that's all the more reason that Rankin Bass should return for Rudolph's shiny new millennium or whatever. And why did they one with a millennium? They really should have made it that when we hit the millennium. What a wasted opportunity.
Okay, I was wrong. 1776 was the signing of the Declaration of Independence.
Oh,
not okay. Not the actual winning of the Revolutionary War.
Oh, well, I guess that was a pretty important thing, you know, signing that declaration and all that.
Yeah.
Well, anyway, I guess anything else we should say about Rudolph, or did we cover everything?
I think we've covered everything. So, you know, I am looking forward to visiting the island of the year 2023 and going back and seeing us recording these over and over again.
That is, I think, the biggest defining thing about 2023.
Yeah, we did podcasts. So, yeah. So, oh, God, the year 2023 is going to look like a two-headed hybrid of us.
Oh, my God. Yeah, I think so. Oh, my God. You know what? It would be very weird if you, like, went to these islands and every year that, like, that you visited that was during your lifetime, it was basically just, like, tailored specifically to you.
Oh, man.
Yeah. So you met, you know, it'd be kind of weird.
Rudolph didn't visit any year that he himself was alive.
Yeah. You know, it'd just be weird if you like, oh, I'm going to go visit, you know, the year, you know, 1987 and just be like, oh, this whole island is like Lakewood Elementary School, you know? That would be kind of weird.
All right. Let's go to the year 19. Yeah. Oh man. We could go back and see, you know, all the best movies in theaters that we missed. Well, let's go see Dune.
Oh yeah. Oh, you know, I think the important thing is we have to go back to the year 2001 and warn them that 9/11 is coming.
Oh boy, that would change history.
But only for the day, because it would happen again tomorrow.
Oh yeah, you're right.
Actually, yeah. Now talk about a year that's going to be one day. You go to the year 2001, and some guy who's like, I don't know, like covered in like asbestos dust and like bleeding from a head wound tells you like, don't worry, I know it's December where you are, but it's always September 11th on this island. Oh God.
We're always having a parade for police and firefighters.
Would the year of 2001 look like Osama bin Laden, or do you think he'd look more like George W. Bush?
Oh man. Oh, the devil you know or the devil you don't. Oh.
I think I know. Okay. It would not be either of those guys, because as we all know, the real puppet master, if you lived through that time, was Dick Cheney. So he would look like Dick Cheney.
Yeah, okay. I was going to say America's mayor, but yeah,
Oh God. Yeah, man, it would be really wild to like visit the island. Like, oh yeah. 2001 America's mayor Giuliani. That's what the guy looks like. And then you visit 2023 where it's like Nosferatu Giuliani. what a change. Anyway,
what year did all the vampire stories happen?
Oh, that was, boy, that would probably be like, when did Stoker write Dracula? That would be like
mid-1800s, right?
Yeah, so. I feel like that's a vampire year, because vampires are always dressed like that.
Wasn't that the year without a summer?
Yeah, that was you actually, you know what? You're right. The year without a summer would be the year that all the scary stuff happened. So that'd be like your Transylvania year. It would basically be like going to Transylvania, because it's got Frankenstein and Dracula happening, right?
Yeah. How old did those people live to be? None of them ever got to see any of the movies made of their work, did they?
No, I don't think so. Because that was what, like mid 1800s, early 1800s. I know I could look it up, but that would ruin the truthiness of this. Because again, we're saying these islands are defined by the popular memory of them. So actually looking up reality would kind of spoil the whole thing.
Truthiness is the right word for that. Yeah. The way that it feels true, even if it's not.
But yeah, I think so. You get the Okay, that's what Rudolph needs to go in the sequel. Go to the Transylvania island.
Rudolph's shiny Halloween.
Oh yeah.
And that's how Rudolph ends it. He says, "Happy New Year, and may it be shiny too." It was like, oh great! Just when I thought I was starting to like Rudolph, turns out he's in a firefly.
Curse your son of an inevitable betrayal, Rudolph. He's like, you know, Rudolph just comes up at the end. He's like, okay, everyone, it's really important that you all write letters to, what is it, Fox? I don't remember what channel it was on. We need to all write letters so that they know that we all, and then, okay, now I gotta go, I'm gonna retire to my bedroom with my copy of Whedonistas, the world of Joss Whedon and the women who love him. Yeah, talk about like, okay, late 90s island is gonna be late personified in late 90s Joss Whedon. You know, flying high with his Buffy the Vampire Slayer. Actually, the whole island is just like Joss Whedon fiction happening. So it's like Buffy happening and what is the other Firefly and all that shit. Yeah. And then you
Welcome
go to the
dollhouse. Yeah.
Yeah. And then you go to the, what is the island that's in, I don't know what, 2019, where it's post Me Too Joss Whedon, you know, where it's like, oh man, that's a different, that is a different island. What a wow.
He really was a leaf on the wind.
Yeah. I do like the idea of different islands being personified by the same person but different stages in their life, which is because you know. But anyway, so
2008 and 2012 would probably both be personified by, you know, young, vibrant Obama and Grandpa Grayhair Obama.
Oh yeah, man. I feel like going to the Watergate island would be a real trip, you know?
Oh wow. The year looks like G. Gordon Liddy.
Yeah. but yeah, so trying to think like, the island, what year did we do the moon landing? Because I bet that'd be a great island. That would be like 69. The big sci-fi island. 69. So that would be the sci-fi island. Because it's like, because you go there and they'd be like, oh, 1969. This is a year that we all went into space. So all the science fiction happened this year, you know?
1969 was also the year that Sesame Street premiered. So what was the year that everyone was a Muppet?
Oh, man. That would be an island to visit.
I would retire there.
To the Muppet Island. It'd basically be like Living Island from Sid and Marty Croft.
Oh, yeah, Living Island, yeah.
Which, again, that's a very another, that'd probably be a 1970s island that just looks like Sid and Marty Croft.
What year did McDonald Land happen?
Yeah. What year was Woodstock? Because that would be a good island, too.
67.
67, oh, no, okay. 68. Okay, and was that also the Summer of Love? I think that was, wasn't it?
67 was the Summer of Love.
Oh, okay. All right. So there are a couple of years.
Oh,
like
no,
one would
was
be
69. Oh, okay. So there's so much happening in 69.
Wow. Okay. So the 69. Yeah, 69. You have like a bunch of Okay. That island
would
just be
hippie Muppet astronauts.
Yeah, hippie. Oh, this is awesome. This is great. You know, we're ready. Like, okay. Like Rankin Bass should call us. We've got a great idea for him. So. But,
oh, and let's not forget the year that all those Rankin Bass specials happened. That's going to be confusing.
Oh, yeah. 1970. Wonderful.
Yeah. We had to rescue Christmas so many times that year. We just want Christmas to stay saved.
It's just like, well, I don't know why they hate Christmas so much. They just keep trying to stop it. man. so, yeah. Lots of fun happening with Rudolph and the year that was. I think this is actually, you know, one of the stronger Rankin Bass specials.
Yeah. When I hear you talk about not liking them, you often bring up Santa Claus is Coming to Town, I think. That seems to be the one you had a bad experience with.
I mean, I don't hate them. Like, not for real. Most of them, I'm just kind of like, I watch, and I'm just like, eh, you know, they're for yeah. kids. There's not much, you know, a lot of them are just kind of like, yeah, they exist, whatever. They kill yeah. time. You know, they don't really have much, like the Santa Claus coming to town. I can't, like, that one is the one where it's, is that what
the
Winter
that
Warlock
you cited as being really annoying and all of it's like, that's why Santa wears red. That's why Santa has a beard. That's why Santa eats cookies.
Yeah, I remember that. Like, that's, you know, whatever. It's that's an annoying one. Plus, you know, it's interesting that Santa doesn't really have a canon, does he? Like,
not really. He has a mythology, but not a canon.
Yeah, like, you could just make up any origin to Santa Claus because we don't have, as a culture, we haven't agreed on one. He's just there, you know? But I guess that's the case for most of our holiday characters. They don't really have origin stories. They aren't really
only Rudolph really does.
Yeah, and that's because he was invented by a grocery store, so... that's...
The Frosty, we know that he was brought to life by a magic hat, but it was Rankin Bass who explained the origins of the hat itself.
Yeah, that's interesting because, like, you know, mythological characters generally have stories. You know, like Hercules has a story, and the story also includes where he comes from and stuff like that. But like characters that are associated with holidays, they're not. They don't have stories. I mean, there are stories about them, but not like established ones that we all agree on. Like, no, we won't. You aren't. If you're going to do a thesis about Santa Claus and try to prove, you know, his origin, you can't really cite Rankin Bass specials. People aren't going to accept that. But they're not like what? I mean, they're not like. What are they actually? What is Santa Claus? He's not a god. He's just kind of. He's. What is he?
Off in older stuff, he is referred to as like an elf. And in a lot of countries, their annual gift giving figure is like a literal gnome or niece or Eunice, that kind of thing. But America's Santa Claus, and by extension, a lot of countries' Father Christmas, is clearly supposed to be an old man who seems to have achieved immortality, unless you're doing something like the Santa Claus where they just pass it along.
I think Santa Claus is interesting because it's hard, you know, like it's hard to define him as like, okay, is he like a human or a god or a demigod or a, you know, or a genius loci or, you know, exactly. I do think like you could probably make like just a really, I think the strongest argument, it is interesting, is because nobody ever makes it, is that Santa Claus is a wizard because he looks like a wizard. He's got the beard and he can do magic and he lives forever. He's basically, that's what stuff wizards do. But like, you don't really talk about Santa as a wizard, you know, which is the same way that like we don't talk about priests as wizards, even though they're basically wizards, you know?
I don't know. Basing wizards on priests? Or are we basing priests on wizards?
Well, I think because, you know, in the old days, the wizard class, like priests would, wizards were probably more interchangeable. Like if you have someone who's like, you know, a medicine man or a shaman, it's like, what kind of role is that? They kind of fulfill both the role of a wizard and of a priest. And I think like nowadays, like those things have kind of been separated in the popular imagination, even though like, okay, what does a priest do? Well, the priest does magic, right? Because he makes the water into wine. That's a magic thing. He's performing magic. He's a wizard. Okay? And people are like...
Do priests turn water into wine? I thought they turned wine into Jesus' blood.
Wait. Oh, that's right. Thank you. It's wine and Jesus' blood. I'm sorry. Jesus did water into wine, which is an even better move, to be honest.
It's bigger wizard.
I mean,
he was the...
Yeah.
You know, he was the sorcerer, and these guys are just bringing brooms to life.
Yeah, because I mean, I think if you ask people like, okay, what's a better trick, water into wine or wine into blood? People will be like, we really prefer the water into wine thing. That's way better. Big crowd pleasing move. But yeah, so priests turn wine into blood. Okay, so which is magic, right? And you'd say, yeah, but like they're not doing magic because they don't have a wand they wave around. They just perform they do a ritual, you know, and God does the actual magic, right? But
well, now I mean, you're that's catching how on.
Yeah, but see, the thing is, that's how wizards work. Generally, they don't do the magic themselves. You do rituals to appease spirits or demons or angels or whatever and have them intercede on your behalf, you know, to do the actual magic. That's what all goetic magic is. It's just catching a demon and making it do the thing. You don't do the magic, you know? So technically, like, wizards are doing the same thing. They're just getting God to do the actual work, you know? Yeah. They're really just middlemen.
Capture God and make him do tricks.
I mean, you know, I don't know if anyone's ever tried it. I feel like, has anyone ever tried to like do the binding circle and summon God? I don't know if it'd go very well, you know?
Did you put, I mean, there is at least one very popular video game where it's possible to catch God and put him in a Pokeball.
Oh, really? What is it?
Pokemon.
Oh, you can catch God in that one?
Yeah, one of the Pokemon called Arceus is in fact supposed to literally be the creator of the entire universe.
Wow, I do love that Japan just does stuff like that.
Yeah,
it's very it's like when they were like making Evangelion and they were like, put some more crucifixes in it. Yeah, it'll look cool, you know. Or they made Altered Beast and they're like, okay, we need. This honorable pagan centurion needs to defeat this evil Christian wizard.
It's funny looking at old illustrations from The Legend of Zelda from before when it was new. And they were like, well, what do European fantasies love? They're like, they're Christians, right? Let's have Link kneeling at a giant cross with a dead Jesus on top.
Like he's that Calvin bumper sticker.
Yeah, exactly.
that's so funny that it is just really funny seeing that sort of thing. It's like when you know, when here in the West we get like, I'm gonna get this tattoo that says like, you know, honor on it and just says milk, you know. But I guess it's funny that like it's funny when like the Japanese are like, let's put some exotic American stuff in this. Cause you know, cause we do the same thing to them. So it just shows how deep down we're all the same. We just love wacky foreigners. We all do. Yeah. Or we should, you know, maybe we could all get along better if that was the case, yeah. But
yeah, maybe we could get along better if we all just took off our hats and let our ears bounce out, you know?
Yeah. Yeah, exactly. You know, don't take yourself so seriously. We could all learn to live and laugh and love as a family. As a brotherhood of man.
That's a good sentiment to start the new year on.
Yeah. Anyway, I hope that your 2024 is shiny and new, and let's all work together to get Firefly back.